Eschan presents educational video lectures as per the AICTE curriculum. Difficult concepts made easy. Study anywhere, anytime.
Hello students, today we are going to talk about the subject-verb agreement, which is also known as concurred. Why the subject-verb agreement is important so as to construct sentences correctly and accurately. What is a subject and what is a verb? That is something we already talked about, but we need to know what is parts of speech so that we can understand the usage of these parts of speech in the sentence. So today we are going to discuss about majorly subject-verb agreement, you know, and then followed by parts of speech and articles and all those important relevant technical things in grammar. Welcome to Eschan Academy. I'm Dr. Vidushi Bhardwaj. We are going to discuss about the subject-verb agreement and concurred, grammatical as well as notional concurred, parts of speech and all those important things which are relevant for accuracy in language. In English today. If you wish to learn more about vocabulary building, sentence construction, all the technicalities of grammar, reading comprehension, parts of speech, sentence construction, you may refer to English for Engineers, which is a wonderful book which will cover all the aspects we have already discussed. And of course, the book has a lot of examples where you can practice, and this will help you improve your vocabulary as well. The ebook link of this book has been given in the description box. You can refer to it. So we proceed to the first thing, which is subject-verb agreement, which is also known as concurred. Now, what is a subject-verb agreement in English? The basic meaning of the subject-verb agreement is that the subject in a sentence and verb, they have to agree with each other in terms of their number. So the subject-verb agreement is an important element because the subject should agree with verb in number as well as in person. Now, why this agreement is important is for a reason. When this is not in agreement with the number of the verb, of course, there will be inaccuracy of language and we may go wrong in terms of writing and speaking of English. Now, a sentence that has a singular subject is accompanied by a singular verb, while subject-verb agreement should be in between words in gender, number, case, person, or any other grammatical category which affects the forms of words. So basically, what does it mean is that when we have a singular subject, it is followed by a singular verb. When we have a plural subject, it is followed by a plural verb, usually speaking. So for example, when I say he plays in the playground and the next is they play in the playground. Or if I say the boy sings a beautiful song, boys sing a beautiful song. So the boys is a plural subject, followed by a plural verb which is sing. Similarly, he is a singular subject followed by a singular verb which is plays. Now this subject-verb agreement, this concept is known as concurred. Now one of the important elements of this subject-verb agreement is, you know, is dependent upon the parts of speech, which we'll elaborate a little later. But first of all, let us proceed to the concurred in these sentences so as to understand this better. Now you can have a look at sentences under A and B. The first sentence says the book is on the table. The second one says the books are on the table. Child likes sweets, children like sweets. The boy has left, boys have left. Now when it's a singular subject, we have the verb which is. When it's a plural subject, the books, the verb is are, and so on. So we can see this kind of concurred or agreement where the same number of verb is followed by the same number of subject. This is known as grammatical concurred. That means singular subject followed by a singular verb, plural subject followed by a plural verb is known as grammatical concurred. But on the contrary, we have something which is known as notional concurred. Now we'll come to this a little later. Let us see these examples first. In the column A, for example, if the sentence is the public consists of all kinds of people, The second sentence says, the public are tired of agitations and strikes. So in the first sentence, we have the public as one unit, as one single entity, followed by verb which is consists. In the second sentence, the public is not a single entity. It is considered as people who form the public. So it is followed by a plural verb. So the members of the public are important here, while in the first one, public as one unit is important here. So that is the reason in the second column, we have used a plural verb are with the same subject, which is public. Let us see the next sentence now. The audience on college day was huge, while the audience were getting bored and restless. So the audience remains the same, you know, visibly speaking. But actually the audience in the first case is a single entity, a single unit. But in the second case, the audience means the people who form the audience separately. So that is the reason we consider it as separate entities, where the plural verb follows the audience. So restless here will be for the people who are getting restless. And here the audience was huge in terms of one unit. So this particular column in sentence A, we see grammatical concord. The same number of subject followed by the same number of verb. While in the second column, we see it's known as the system where one unit is considered as visibly one unit, but the people who form that unit independently will be following a plural verb. So this kind of concord is known as notional concord. So as the word suggests, notion means an idea, something which is an idea, which is not a reality. But in this case, we call it a notional concord because visibly speaking, the public looks like one entity. Similarly, the committee looks like one entity, but it is actually the members of the committee who were divided on the choice of the president. As compared to the first sentence where the committee was unanimous on the choice of the secretary. So that is how we see the difference between a grammatical concord and notional concord. So when we see in the second part, the singular subject is followed by plural verb, when the committee is followed by verb, neighbor's family is followed by quarrel, we see that the members are considered here individually, and that is how agreement of this kind, where a singular subject visibly is followed by a plural verb, because the subject is not a single entity, it is composed of the members who form that subject. This kind of agreement is known as notional concord. And it's very important to understand this concept in grammar, because when we are framing sentences, if we do not understand the subject-verb agreement of this kind, we will not be accurate in the usage of the language. Okay, so in these sentences, when the first sentence says a large number of people dash applied for this job, the verb given here should be have. Similarly, the majority of the students are boys. More than 1,000 members have signed for this petition. So in these sentences, the head word of the subject is singular. That means number, majority, and more. But the verb is plural, as the noun phrase as a whole expresses a plural idea. For example, people, students, and members, they're all plural. But when we started with the sentences, it's all about the number, majority, and more than 1,000 members. So what we are trying to say here is, we are bothered about this people, students, and members who are plural in number. And according to the principle of proximity or nearness, the verb will take the number of the noun which is closest to it. So people, students, members, since they are plural, we will use the plural verb here. Even if the number, majority, and the third one looks singular visibly. Look at these sentences now. Either you or your brothers dash to answer for this. So most of you will be confused as to what should be the answer. So either you or your brothers, where we use either or, people are confused. What should be the verb? But again, according to the, you know, principle of proximity, either you or your brothers have to answer for this. So, brothers become the closest subject. Either your brothers or your sister has to answer for this, because sister is the closest subject to the blank. Nobody, not even the members, were present. In each of these sentences, verb takes the noun in the subject which is nearest to it. Now, there has to be a lot of explanation on this, because people usually get confused with either or, neither, non kind of sentences. But here also the principle of proximity will be the one which will be considered. So, according to the proximity or nearness, the closest subject number will be considered in order to fill in the blank for the verb. So, basically there are three principles in subject-verb agreement which we just discussed about. The principle of grammatical concord, principle of notional concord, and the principle of proximity. I'll repeat: grammatical concord, where the number of the subject and number of verb match. They are in agreement with each other. Singular subject followed by singular verb, plural subject followed by plural verb. Notional concord, where the number of subject and verb do not match. Visibly, the subject looks like a singular entity, but actually speaking, we consider the subject as the members or the individuals who form the subject, and that is the reason it is being followed by a plural verb. We had given so many examples in the past. And the principle of proximity, where the verb takes the number of the subject which is closest to it, to avoid any confusion. So, moving ahead, look at these sentences, try to solve them together. Mr. John or Mr. Samuel dash to move the resolution. Now, there is a connector or. When we have a connector or, either or, neither nor, Mr. Samuel or Mr. John has to move the resolution, because we are talking about two single people. Either Ravi or Raju has damaged the lock again. Neither the Boy Scouts nor the Girl Guides. So, neither nor. We have guides here, so we should be writing R. We should not be going with the first subject. We should be going with the number of second subject according to the principle of proximity. Either my own son or those children. Now, children is a plural noun. Have done this. So, it should not be confused with son here. This is the first subject. Good and bad behavior are inculcated by example, because there are two clauses. If you remember, in the past lectures we talked about the clauses. Clause is an independent sentence in itself with the subject and predicate of its own. So, two clauses here are: good behavior is inculcated by example and bad behavior is inculcated by example, but taken together it becomes a plural. So, good and bad behavior are inculcated by example as a plural entity. Now, what should be written here? None of them is right or none of them are right. So, none of them means out of many, one, not even one, is right. And we have to be very, very careful with the usage of such sentences, because when we say them, we feel that again it's many. So, we should go by principle of proximity, but we should not go by principle of proximity here. There are always exceptions in grammar. So, none means not even one out of them, out of many. So, when we say not even one of them is right, not are right. Either you or I am mistaken. I am mistaken, if we take it, you know, independently. So, a boy with his sister and brother. Now, this is a very important usage. A boy, which is a subject, which is a singular in number, with his sister and brother. Here, the main subject is boy, not the sister and brother. We should not be considering sister and brother as the subject. The subject here is a boy. So, a boy with his sister and brother is standing at the gate. So, there has to be a clarity of usage here, because these are all the rules we are talking about. But on the other hand, when we use as well as, the rule changes. So the chairman as well as the members are to blame for this misfortune. As in contrast to the previous sentence, when we used with, we will go with the first subject. When we use as well as, we will go with the other members also, because it becomes a part of the subject. What I say and do are none of your business. Again, they have two clauses, what I say and what I do. Billiards is a rich man's game. Like we say, politics is a dirty game. So all those subjects or nouns which end with S may not necessarily be plural, right? So we have to understand, physics is a difficult subject. So we use is with physics. So these rules have to be taken care of. So the key takeaways of this lecture were that we talked about the concord, that means subject-verb agreement. We discussed in detail about grammatical concord, notional concord, and the principle of proximity, along with a few examples which illustrated the rules for the subject-verb agreement also. If you wish to learn more about vocabulary building, sentence construction, all the technicalities of grammar, reading comprehension, parts of speech, sentence construction, you may refer to English for Engineers, which is a wonderful book which will cover all the aspects we have already discussed. And of course, the book has a lot of examples where you can practice, and this will help you improve your vocabulary as well. The ebook link of this book has been given in the description box. You can refer to it. If you like the video, please like, share, and subscribe to our channel and press the bell to get updates about the future videos.
All rights reserved. This video has been prepared for educational purposes only. No part of it may be reproduced or copied without the permission of the copyright holder.